No, that wasn't too much. Come on, help me thank God for your pastor, Mr. Paul Perry. Listen, whenever that happens, whenever somebody asks you to appreciate your pastor, it's not just clapping, but when you're thankful for your pastor and you show it, that gives you access to the anointing that's on his life. You show honor. Honor gives you access to the blessing on his life. You believe he's blessed? Come on, let's thank God for your bishop.
In a boat, the boat is in the water, and there are
there is a multitude of people on the land. And he taught, say taught. And he taught them many things by parables, and said unto them in his doctrine. Verse 40. And he said unto them, why are ye so fearful? How is it that you have no faith? Let's go over this one more time. Let's go back to verse 1. And he began to teach by the seaside. Say, teach. And there was gathered unto him a great multitude. A great multitude. They came for teaching. He wasn't hooping, he wasn't hollering, he wasn't straining. He was teaching, and a great multitude came for teaching. What did they come for?
Teaching.
So that he entered into a ship and sat in the sea. And the whole multitude was by the sea on the land. And he taught, say, and he taught.
And he taught.
Listen to what he taught, how he taught. He taught them many things by parables. And said unto them his doctrine. Verse 40. And he said unto them, now he's talking to the disciples, who he taught, along with the multitude, he says unto them, why are you so fearful? Why, how is it that you have no faith? A word for the storm to come. You with me so far? Word for the storm to come. Marcus is one of my favorites. Gospels, my favorite Gospels. And people that read the Bible, anybody here? Bible readers? Bible readers? When you read the Bible, Mark chapter 4 is known for two things. It's known, one, for this parable of the sower. Parable of the sower. How the sower sowed. Then it is known because in it, the saying of Jesus, let us go over to the other side, right? The story of the disciples of Jesus in a ship, in a storm, and Jesus asleep. Y'all heard that parable before, that story? So Mark 4, it is known for those two things, the sower parable and Jesus on the ship being sleep. So let's go back to verse 1. So Mark introduces this chapter, this section of his gospel, by telling us that Jesus is teaching by the seaside. He's teaching by the seaside. Say, by the seaside. He's teaching. He's giving instruction to the people. He's giving instruction. And he's giving instruction to the people by using parables. He's giving instruction to the people by using parable. A parable is a short story that teaches a moral or spiritual lesson. Right? So Jesus is teaching life lessons to the crowd and to his disciples. Right? And he's using parables. In this particular time, he uses the parable of the sower. But there are a couple of things I want you to catch in the text. Here's what it says. Two. You still have your Bibles open?
Yes, sir.
All right, in verse 2, here's what it says. And he taught them many things by parables. Read that with me. And he said unto them, well, he taught them many things by what?
Parables.
All right, so Jesus taught them many things by parables, which says this bishop, that not everything he taught was written. Missing. All right. So not everything he said was written. Right? Not all his teaching is written. However, the writer of Mark does think that the sower of the parable of the sower is necessary to put in the script. It's part of the Bible. So whatever Jesus taught, they chose from his teaching and put the parable of the sower into the text. Are you still with me? Right, so Mark he records these parable of the sower, and he says, let's look at it, as Jesus is teaching, he talks about the sower and how the sower is sowing and where the seed fell on good ground and how the seed fell by the wayside and what have you. So, Jesus is teaching and he gives this parable of the sower. Parable of the sower. So usually at the end of the parable, the meaning of the parable is included. The meaning of the parable is included in the parable because Jesus is teaching in parables and he's giving the people instruction through parables, right? Which means that they have to be really paying attention to what Jesus is saying in order to understand and get the meaning of the parable for their lives because he is instructing them on how to live everyday life. Are you with me so far? Let me cut to the chase and get to the end of the parable. I just want to deal with it. I don't want to spend a lot of time on the parable itself. But let me just give you this. At the end of the parable, here's what we learned. How about your neighbor tell your neighbor, here's what we learned. Here's what we learned. That the seed is the word of God. Right? Okay, verse 14. You want to follow that? The seed is the word of God. Say that. The seed is the word of God. And the seed of the word of God is sown into the hearts of the hearers. So as the word is going forth, the word is seed, and that seed is dropped into the heart of the people that hear it. But watch this, he said, the word of God, the seed of the word, has enemies. Watch this. Because anytime the word is being taught, all right, it is the seed that drops in your heart that is supposed to produce fruit. No hero is supposed to be fruitless. Sometimes we blame our fruitlessness on the pastor or the church or the location. It don't have anything to do with it. There are enemies listed. Enemies of your fruit are listed, and it's not your church. Y'all missed me right there. And it's not your bishop. It's not your first lady. There are several enemies to the word that is sown into the heart of the hearers that is listed. Watch this. The first enemy is, verse 15, Satan. I don't care if y'all don't shout. It don't matter. It don't bother me. I'm not impressed with shouting. I'm impressed with fruit. Somebody says Satan. So as soon as the word is sown into your heart that is supposed to produce fruit, Satan comes to snatch that word right out of your heart. And some of y'all today, before you get to the parking lot, to your car, the enemy is going to come and snatch that word out of your heart so that it don't bring forth fruit. And then your work, your life ends up looking the same after church as it did before church. I need 35 people with your hand at me shout, but not today, not today. He is an enemy of the seed of the word. There's another one in verse 17. Are you still there?
Yeah.
There's an enemy of the word, and they're listed in verse 17. Affliction, persecution, and offense are enemies to the seed of the word that is in your life. Because the word that is given, people spring up with excitement about the word. Oh, did he teach? Oh, Bishop Sue just taught us. Oh, my God. Oh, and that's all you got. Then when you get out in real life, persecution and affliction and offense come, all right? And that excitement then dwindles, and your life is still fruitless, and then your excitement is dead. So you're not only no longer excited about the word, excited about church, but you're also fruitless. Fruitless. Somebody shout, my fruitless days are over. There's another enemy to the word. It says in the next verse, verse 19. Watch this. Cares of this world, deceitfulness of riches, lust of other things. Here's what happens. It chokes the word. Wow. Cares of this world. Some of y'all sit here now and say, man, I'm going to work Tuesday. have a light bill, man.
Yes.
And I got, and you receive a teaching, and it's choking it out because I'm giving it to you. The word is being choked. Shoes and you're choking the word out of your eyes. Right? So these things are the enemy to the word, so that the word cannot produce fruit in the life of the hearer. So Jesus teaches in parables, teaches the people in parables because he wants their life to be fruitful. Get somebody by the hand. Get them by the hand. Talk to them for a minute. Get them by the hand and tell them, Jesus wants your life to be fruitful. To be fruitful. The devil around you shouting praise and dancing. Can't nobody in here make me dance. But when I get them dancing, if all I got on my tree are leaves, I'm fruitless. Right? And we count as believers go through life, go through life with our hand out, waiting on somebody to bless us, when God has designed you to be a blessing. If you heard me, wave your hand. If you heard me, wave your hand. No more fruitlessness. There's too much word in this church for you to be fruitless.
Your life.
So if the enemy is attacking your life, it is the teaching the word. In verse 33, he is teaching the word as they are able to hear it. In verse 34, he expounded. Expound means explain all things to his disciples. So he's talking to the crowd and he's talking to his disciples.
Right.
He's teaching the crowd, he's teaching his disciples. He's speaking to the crowd, he's speaking to his disciples. He's explaining to the crowd, he's explaining to his disciples. Lord have mercy. Lord have mercy. He's teaching the crowd, he's teaching his disciples. He's speaking to the crowd, he's speaking to his disciples. He's explaining it to the crowd, he's explaining it to his disciples. Oh God. No matter those who are far away from him and those that are close to him, they get the same word. They get the same word. He's teaching the crowd, he's teaching his disciples. He's speaking to the crowd, he's speaking to his disciples. Lord have mercy. He's explaining to the crowd, he's explaining to his disciples. He's giving them the word, he's sowing seed into the lives of the people and his disciples. Lord have mercy. Verse 1 and 2, what is he doing?
Teaching.
Verse 33, what is he doing?
Speaking.
Verse 34, what is he doing?
Explaining.
Verse 1 and 2, what is he doing?
Teaching.
Verse 33, what is he doing?
Speaking.
And verse 34, what is he doing?
Explaining.
And in verse 35, what happened? Can you see it?
Yes, sir.
What happened? Let me read it to you. Verse 35 and verse 37. Just part of it. Verse 35. You there?
Yes, sir.
And the same day. Say the same day.
Yes,
the same day he was teaching, speaking, explaining. Same day.
Same day.
Come on now.
Same day.
Y'all ain't it okay. Same day. Because in a storm, you need foundation. Matthew 7:24. Lord, have mercy.
Yes, God. Yes, God.
Therefore, whosoever heareth these sayings of mine, there's that hearer. Hear me saith the mind and does them. I will liken him unto a wise man which built his house upon a rock foundation.
Yeah. Yeah.
And when the rain descended, storm, and the flood came, storm, and winds blew, storm, and beat upon that house, storm, and it fell not. Why? Because the house was founded on a rock.
Storm, the boat will be traveling through the storm, But in this text, the storm is now in the boat.
Yeah. Yeah. You're listening.
Yeah.
We do well when we're going through the storm and we're just traveling through the storm.
Right.
But when the storm gets in us, some of us can't praise because we're full of storm. Filled it with water, but it didn't disturb the world.
The word is stormproof. Say that. The word.
The word.
I got 6 minutes. The word is stormproof. Say that.
The word
is stormproof.
Stormproof.
I may have one in my book.
Yes, sir.
My shoes may be going through hell.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
But
yes, sir.
The word. Not my heart.
Yes, sir.
No.
I've been through some storms, Wolf, that crushed my heart.
Yes, 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 yes.
I've been through some storms, disturbed my mind to the place I couldn't sleep. But that word can't get to that storm. Can't get to that word that's down in my stomach. Woo! Somebody holler! I got a word. The storm can't kill my word. Tell you why we give up in the storm, because we fail to tap into the word.
Yeah.
Why are we
giving? We pay more attention to the storm.
That's
it, the word that is on the inside of us. So there are two dynamics at work, Bishop Perry. The two dynamics at work. One,
yes, sir. Yes, sir.
First dynamic is Jesus, the word, is rested in the storm.
Yes.
And the second dynamic is, watch this, when you're going through the storm, a silent word cannot quiet your storm. You can be full of the word, but if you don't open your mouth in the middle of your storm and speak to it, your storm will continue to rage and you will continue to worry. I'm going back to that. Y'all not seeing it. Y'all not seeing it. Go get your Bible back. Go get your Bible. that we bear, what he do? Verse 39. Wait a minute. What he do? No. What he do first? He rose. If you go handle your storm, first thing you got to do is get up. You letting the wind hit you? You letting the rain hit you? You letting it beat you? You just that all the stuff. You got to get up. Tell your neighbor, tell him, get up, get up, get up. You got to get up. Your circumstance is not going to change as long as you lay down and let it be what it be. The first thing you got to do is get up. Lay out in your circumstance and lay out in your storm and complain. Looking at God saying, you don't care about me, Lord. You don't care about me, Jesus. If you cared about me, you wouldn't get out. You would have got me out of here. Jesus said, well, why are you in the storm with your back closed? Get up and open up your mouth.
He
got up, look what happened. He got up, what happened? What's next? And he did what? And he did what?
He
spoke to
him. Yeah.
He responded. You got the power to rebuke your storm.
Yeah.
And then what happened? He said to the sea, what? He stood still. And then what happened? And the wind ceased. And there was what?
Calm.
So verse 4, he says to them, why are you so fearful?
Yeah.
Okay, now let me close. So you remember that Peter and him, James and John, they were fishers. Remember? They was always on the Sea of Galilee. They weren't scared of the storm. They had been in so many storms before. They weren't scared of the weather. They saw storms before. Jesus, why are you so fearful? Why are you not operating in what I told you? Why does this have no faith? Why didn't you do what I just did? Why didn't you speak to it?
Yeah, right. Come on.
Why didn't you talk to it?
Uh-huh. Come on.
What are you afraid of? Talk to it.
Yes.
Open the mouth. Talk to
it.
And what will it have to do? Obey.
That's it.
Stand to your feet. I'm finished. I'm finished.
Yes, sir.
Maybe I should have bought one of them good old Holland sermons or something.
No, sir. That's it. That's on purpose. Thank you, sir.
There's some storms coming.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Yes,
sir. I said there's some storms coming.
Yes.
And you're going to need to learn how to operate the next storm. You got to operate better the next storm than you need this storm. Put your arm around somebody. Put your arm around somebody. Just tell them, this time I was too quiet. I didn't talk to it. I didn't speak to it. I let it rage. And instead of me speaking to my storm, I became emotional. I speak to this emotional storm, this financial storm, relationship storm, mental storm. I speak to it right now. Be still. Be still.
Yes, yes, yes.
Be still.
I speak to my own emotions. Be still. I speak to the pain in my whole heart and body. Be still. I speak my faith. Be still. Open your mouth, little journey. Come on. Come on. Give me 30 more seconds. Come on.